and briefly introduce myself before narrating to you my 50 years adventure life experience in 45 minutes. After the hilarious and romantic narration of his adventure of Kedar, I cannot, I'm sorry to disappoint you, I can't leave the stage because my wife happens to be here. Anyway, I joined the, I'm now 80 years young. I joined the Army Academy in 1950. Got my commission in 54 in Corps of Electronics and Mechanical Engineer and retired in 92. So I'll tell you briefly about my pre-retirement and post-retirement activity. And I'll also keep on narrating to you the lessons that I learned, which I benefited from and which I would like to share with you. When I bought my first scooter, Lembretta, in 1956, I asked my friend, Second Lieutenant Rekhi, I was also Second Lieutenant then, you know, for any tip. He told me, any fool can ride a motorcycle or scooter on a straight road, but a wise driver caters for the side traffic, the crossings, and the corners. I put that in my mind, and I benefited a lot from it. And incidentally, I happened to meet that Second Lieutenant Rekhi again, now retired as a colonel in Chennai. He settled there. I said, look, Sujinder, I remember your advice, and anything else you can give me. So after little hesitation, he said, I had come on a scooter to South India, and I had visited Chennai. He said, please, when you overtake anything, please don't run parallel to it. Only when you are absolutely certain that you will go past, then only you speed up and cross and then get on to the left. But never run parallel to it. I said, thank you very much. Then, when I bought my first scooter, I hope you can hear me at the back.
Yeah. Yeah. Yes.
And I'm not too loud or something. So, I bought that scooter for 1,750 rupees brand new from Dadaji Dharji and Company in Bombay and rode it to Nagpur, back to Nasik and then Pune, where I was doing a course as a second lieutenant. That was my first journey on a scooter. Later on, I had an Austin car, A70, Hampshire Saloon. I went with my parents and my family. I was not married then. And I came down to South India, did 5,500 kilometers in 40 days, and traveled the entire East Coast and Kanyakumari and Kerala, and went back in that car. Next, in 1975, I happened to go England, and I rented a Ford motor home which had place for sleeping for four and a hammock. I took my mother, because my father had already expired, he was a judge, and he had done his bar at law from England in 1932-33. So my mother, my wife, my youngest daughter, and my aunt who lived in London, so four ladies and myself, we drove in Ford motorhome from London, Dover, Calais, Paris, Versailles, Nice, Monte Carlo, Genova, Pisa, Rome, Vatican, Milan, into Switzerland, Geneva, Zurich, then from there to Cologne, and then a Mercedes car factory we saw, and then from there we drove on to Belgium, Brussels, and from Austin we caught the ferry back to London. So that was my journey in a Ford motorhome. And a very interesting thing that took place, which I'll briefly mention, when we were crossing at the beginning in the hovercraft from Dover to Calais, there were several vehicles on board, so I was in the queue. So I happened to tell my mother while sitting down, this is the handbrake. If the vehicle is to be parked or rolls, you pull this brake. And I made her pull and release it. And everyone did. I told my wife, she said, you know, ye kya mazak kar rahe hain? What is this joke? But anyway, she did pull it and hold it. I don't know why God made me do that. When we drove from, after 7 days from Milan, we were going into Switzerland. There are two tunnels. One is Saint Bernard and the other is Mont Blanc tunnel. I happened to take the Mont Blanc tunnel, not realizing that it was passing through a small patch of France again. I had a single entry visa. So at 2:30 in the night on the Alps, it was snowing. I went there, so we said, Monsieur, you on three, single entry. You go back to Milan and get another visa and then you can come in. I said, look, I've been driving for 7 hours from there. Is there any other way? He said, all right, you go this much, then go, turn this thing and then go to Saint Bernard Tunnel that goes directly into Switzerland. So I was going, and what happened, at one place I found a bifurcation. So I got out and I pulled the handbrake, unfortunately only about half. And I went and I was reading, suddenly I found the vehicle creaking. I ran and I tried to, how could I stop a vehicle like that? I was shouting, you know, pull the brake, pull the brake. And then they were sleeping right next to that. So my wife immediately got up and pulled the handbrake. And that saved our life. Otherwise, my whole family would have been destroyed in that event. So this is God's way of doing it. Why I did it, I don't know. But the lesson was that the handbrake is a very important thing. Normally what, you know, you will find our people say, oh, handbrake kaam nahi kar raha, not working, put it in the gear. No. You need handbrake absolutely, you know, for to save your life. That's the lesson that I learned in that. And then I embarked upon the idea, that was 75. In 92, I retired. So after that, I felt that now I had all the time in the world. I was very busy in my office work. So I said, I'll now look to my hobby of adventure. So I thought, what is the most economical way of doing it? You know, I belong to a very old period. When I, as a class 1 officer, I started on a princely salary of 478 rupees per month as a class 1 officer, second lieutenant. But In those days, the petrol was 2.50 rupees per gallon. And I was able to maintain a car even in those days. So I thought of some economic way of doing it. So I thought I'll go. I had a Bajaj scooter. So I went to Bajaj and I asked them, would you like to sponsor? They said, sorry, we don't have the policy for the sponsoring, and we can't. I was invited by a friend of mine, Colonel G.R. Dhani in Pune. So his daughter was running an aerobic school in Pune, and I happened to visit her. So she told me, uncle, I'm thrilled you're going to London on motorcycle. I said, no, it is called off. Bajaj has said no. She told me, uncle, what about kinetic? I said, I've never driven one. Kinetic owner's granddaughter and her husband are my students. So I'll fix up an appointment for you. She fixed up. I met the grandfather, Mr. Hastimal Firodia, and he asked me to give it how much? I said, 1 lakh. And new bike, spares and all that. He said, I'll let you know after a board meeting in about 4 or 5 days. And I went back to Delhi the same night. On the 4th day, they rang up, we'll give you 50,000, new scooter, spares and all that. I said, fine, accepted. And that's how my this thing got sponsored by Kinetic. Now I had, what I did, I'll share with you. It might be of some use to you. I applied to the Ministry of Youth Affairs and Sports that I want to travel on a scooter by road to England and make permission, please be granted. And if possible, any sponsorship help may be given. They said, sorry, nothing doing. We cater for youth up to 32 years of age. You are 59. So, sorry for that. So I said, at least if you can't do that, at least you can get me any clearance or something. They said, okay. So they sent my application to Ministry of External Affairs. They in turn sent it to Ministry of Home Affairs. And they then sent it back to Ministry of External Affairs and they issued a no objection certificate that this is to certify that Major General R.K. Jain is standing from so-and-so, so-and-so. Ministry of Home has been consulted and they have given clearance and the clearance is hereby accorded for your getting. With this kind of a letter, you see, having a road journey through the different countries would make it possible that it has got a government approval. So this is what I did. And you'll be surprised that I got this all done by personal liaison within a matter of 3 weeks. So having got that, now I have to choose a route. Why the question that I asked Kedar, why you chose Dubai? My route had to be through Pakistan. So when I went to Ministry of External Affairs, Joint Secretary, Iran and Pakistan told me, Iran, no problem. But Pakistan, you will say ex-army officer, Indian army officer, going through this, there is definitely something fishy. So I said, do you mind, I need the High Commissioner, Pakistan. They said, no, we don't mind. I rang up the High Commissioner, Mr. Riaz Khokhar. I said, it's like this. He said, day after tomorrow, 10 o'clock, please come. I went. He called his Deputy High Commissioner, his military advisor, Brigadier Gulzar. And Brigadier Gulzar was eyeing me very, very seriously as to what is my intention of going. But anyway, after 15 minutes, Mr. Riaz Khokhar, the High Commissioner, said, General Sahab, we are fully satisfied with a bona fide. We will recommend your case to the hilt to Islamabad. And how many days do you want? I said, what's the distance? 1800 kilometers. 7 days, they gave. And I went to Pakistan. And it was an uneventful journey till I reached Baluchistan, Quetta. There my bag had got torn, I was getting stitched on the pavement. Two people came in civilian clothes, policemen. They said, your name is Rajendra Kumar Jain. Okay. You are required by DIG police, the Inspector General Police. In my mind, I thought that I had done some omission or something, that they want me. I went, I gave my card. They said, oh, you are from the army, General General, please have a seat. After some time, he gave my passport back. He said, sir, you can go. I said, excuse me, what had gone wrong that you called me here? And what has been righted that you are letting me go? They said, oh, you have not seen. You give me the passport. And I gave the passport. And there was a stamp which the High Commissioner had put, exempted from reporting to police. That is why they said, I salute Mr. Riaz Khokar for his generosity. Anyway, I then, so that was my experience with this. Now I needed the Austrian and German visa. They do not issue visa without your mediclaim. I went to New India Assurance Company. They said, by road journey, mediclaim? Never heard of. They have never given. We can't give. You approached the headquarters, Bombay. I came into Bombay. So they said, sorry, we have no precedent, we can't issue. But there was a lady there. She told me, please don't take my name. General Insurance Corporation of India, they are the policy making body. If they tell us and you satisfy them, maybe your job can be done. I said, all good, okay. I went to GIC, the general manager, Mr. Purohit. I reached at 4:45, Friday. He was moving out for a meeting. I told him, he said, look, you come on Monday. I said, Monday? I am leaving tonight back for Delhi. He said, what do you expect me to do? You come to me, so-and-so, and this thing. I said, well, if you don't help, my whole mission would fail. So then he called the deputy general manager. He said, please look into the problem of this general and try to resolve it if you can. He asked me, is it a racing? I said, no. Is it a rally? I said, no. I said, it is only a mode of travel. He was so quick and positive, he immediately sent a fax to New India that Major General Jain is proceeding on so and so, and he is not on a race, he is not on a rally, you may issue mediclaim. I came back to the office and got the letter, came back to Delhi, and they issued me the mediclaim. I went to German and Austrian embassy and got the visa. Another thing which I want to share with you is something called visa note. It says like this, to an embassy they address. Government of India sends its compliments to the government of Japan and wishes to request that Major General Jain is proceeding from so-and-so to so-and-so by road. And may a visa be issued to him on this thing. And it is embossed. So this thing is not given to any minister. But I dared to walk into the Ministry of External Affairs. I met an additional secretary. Additional secretary is of a Lieutenant General's rank. And I told him. He was so positive. He just called his personal secretary. He said, type out the letter. So and so going, and may visa notes be issued. So they gave me visa note for all the countries. And with that thing, when I went to the embassy, I got the visa. Sitting down there, I used to get the visa. So the object of telling you this was that I started my activity in the month of August of getting this permission, these visas and all. And 14th October, I was flagged off from Delhi by Mr. Rajesh Khanna, our famous film star and then Member of Parliament, and Lieutenant General Ahluwalia in from National Stadium, Delhi. Now, I went across, and at Wagha border, I met one Inspector Akram. He said, "Sir, I am from Pakistan Special Police, and I have been detained to escort you." I said, "Very fine, then I don't have to ask the way." So he said, "Tonight we have to report to a place about 185 kilometers near Sahiwal." I reported there and then carried on to Multan. And after Multan, I did not see them, probably they were keeping an eye, but I don't know how. Then I came to Quetta, and Quetta incident I told you. Then I came. Now there was a patch of 113 kilometers which I had met the travelers coming from Europe into India. So one traveler couple had come in a Unimog 4x4 vehicle, and they said there is no road for 113 kilometers. We took 11 hours to traverse that 113 kilometers with very great difficulty. Your scooter just can't travel. So I decided about 250 kilometers. I traveled by train and I came to the Iranian border at Bazargam. And from there, I came to Zahedan on the east, and the Consul General of India, they were very affectionate. They put me up at the embassy expense in the hotel. And from there, they told me up to Kalmam, 600 kilometers, you don't drink water, that otherwise you fall sick. So they put 3 liter water, and they said, when you finish this, you only take aerated drink. Anyway, I reached Kalmam, then Isfahan, then Tehran. And Tehran also, our ambassador, Mr. Arora, he was very nice. He put me up for 2 nights at the embassy expense there. And then my wife was working with Sita World Travel for 26 years. So they had their counterpart in Iran. So in Tehran, up to the border with Turkey was 900 kilometers via Tigris. So their director took care of me for 3 nights, 300 kilometers, and I passed on into Turkey. Turkey, my experience was, as he was also mentioning, that the scenario changed. Moment I crossed into Turkey, on 1st of November, it was only snow there, absolute snow. I had no snow goggles and all that. So I found it going very difficult because the visor used to get fogged the moment I took 2 or 3 breaths. So it was very difficult. And the first place called Erzurum was 110 kilometers away, which I covered in 10 hours. I covered that 110 kilometers. But when I reached there, I got into the first hotel and put a rajai on top and just went down. Anyway, next day, for the snow portion, I took a bus because it was impossible to drive with the visor fogging. And from there, I again drove to Istanbul. And Istanbul, I rang up Ankara, our embassy, and I told the ambassador that I've come and this thing. So he very kindly arranged for my stay in Istanbul with one Sardarji guest house, and I, so like that. And rest of my journey then through Bulgaria, Romania, Hungary, Austria, Germany, and I left this one. So that's how I, and 16 November, I reached London. That was in 93. In 2004, when I became 70 years, I wanted to do, test whether I could still do it. So along with my son, we decided to go from India to Singapore. So this is my journey from India to Singapore. We came, passed through Myanmar, Thailand, Malaysia, Singapore. From Singapore, my son, I got only one son, he lives in Dubai, and he returned to Dubai, and I flew with the scooter to Australia, and he paid 1.1 lakh, I paid zero. Because Singapore Airlines gave me a complimentary airlift. And then, there I found the road was single with both way traffic, speed 110. They told me, if you drive on the scooter, they cannot overtake you unless it is an overtaking lane every 8 to 10 kilometers. So I first traveled by bus for some distance to see the pattern of traffic, and then I alighted, and then I used to see a vehicle coming. I used to pull to the left, stop, and I used to give a hand like that. And that's how they got the legal permission to sort of overtake and go. And that's how I made through this thing. But wherever there was a dual carriageway, no problem. So I went to Adelaide, Sydney, and Brisbane. And from Brisbane, now this one that I was telling you, is a good thing actually. I was told that through northeast, when you move, you will have security problems. So they had told the General Daljeet Singh, who was in Dimapur, to give me security cover. So he gave, I am explaining him my route. This is General Daljeet Singh, and this is Brigadier Kapoor. So after this, they gave me two armored cars. One more. The next one. No. So we used to move between these two armored cars, and from Dimapur up to the border, Tamu More, he very kindly this thing. And I mean, just between you and me, they also told me that General thought that you might get tired. We have put a Tata Sumo in the line. Yeah, this one. And first they were not giving me permission. But later on, through the intervention of the ex-High Commissioner Pakistan, and who was also ex-High Commissioner Myanmar, the High Commissioner, our High Commissioner Rajesh Bhatia, he told the military junta that Major General Jain is a harmless person. No political repercussion, nothing of the kind. So they gave me permission to drive through this. And this is in a village, my son and myself, we stayed the night here. And next, and at one place when the bridge was broken and the convoy will stop on this side and on that side. I told them that, you know, I have no time. So what they did, they put the immediately girders on the thing and planks, and they lifted our boat scooter. Within 30 minutes, we crossed. Yeah. And this is the kind of road we encountered in Myanmar. This is, we have to be very careful of the nails, that no nail is coming out. Yeah, this one. Yeah. And this is kind of this road, you know. So, and you can see here in this, the knee guard, the elbow guard, and all that kind of a thing, which you are familiar, but they are a must. Yeah. And this is my son and this thing. Journey through Myanmar is climb one mountain, down, another mountain, down, and like that. Then we cross into Thailand, then Thailand to Malaysia. From Thailand, the roads were like silk. Beautiful road. And every, but you know, 60 kilometers before Bangkok, my son's scooter packed up. Because there are no the petrol pumps in Burma, in Myanmar. They're only in Rangoon or in big cities, Mandalay and all. But otherwise, on the way, they've got only, they pour the petrol like that. So the jets got crossed. Now here, I was told, I was not taught how to open the carburetor because they said they are new machines, 10,000 kilometers, you don't have to worry. But it did cross. So my son rang up Noida, Delhi workshop, and the mechanic told me what to open and what to this thing. And in 2 hours, I cleaned the jets and we were on our way again. This is the kind of shelter which is provided every 10 to 15 kilometers on the road where you can rest. This is in a hotel at Tuck. The first day we covered 500 kilometers on scooter from Mesai, northernmost tip, up to Tuck. And second day we covered from Tuck to Bangkok another 500 kilometers because our son was running out of time. So, and from the road patrol were very helpful, and all the embassies had been told by the Director General of Military Intelligence to help us. So they had made arrangements for our stay in the hotel. And here only one point I tell you, you can reach a city, but to reach a place is difficult. So what I told my son, we engage a taxi, give him the address that we want to go here, and drive slowly, we are following behind. So that is how we reach the place without any problem. This is in Malaysia, Kuala Lumpur. And this is Singapore, 40 kilometers. And then we reach, now I am in Australia, alone. So Sydney, 8:45, like that. I carry on to Brisbane. And I stayed with some references I had, and they were wonderful people to help me. And I returned to courtesy of Thai Airways and Air India, back to India. Then, in 2007, I came again to South India and did 4,500 kilometers. And I'm very fond of meeting my friends. So, 16 postmates of mine from the military academy, I met them during this trip, which was from Hyderabad, Sriharikota, Madras, Bangalore, I saw the international air show, then Joke Falls, and to the west coast, and then Karwar, Goa, and like that on Wednesday. And then, in 2007 itself, you heard of Nathula Pass on China border,
yes.
14,400 feet. So I said, you know, I would like to climb back from Gangtok, Sikkim, India. So this is, I am at this stage here. Welcome to Nathula Pass, Sikkim, India, 14,400 feet. I did not stop the engine there. It was 56 kilometers from Gangtok. I thought it may not start again. And I had left at 8 o'clock, reached 11, 11:30 I left back. And 2 o'clock, I came and had a lunch in the officer's mess. Then, this is the 17th Mountain Division, Colonel Q, who was posted in Gangtok, and he helped me tremendously. When I was going up, he put a jeep with a nursing assistant, with a mechanic, with an electrician, and with a driver to follow. So I'm very grateful to him for that. And so this is at Tombo Lake, 12,400 feet. This my team. So this I was able to do. And when I went to Pune to meet the maker of kinetic, they told me, it's impossible, the engine cannot run at that height. It's about 8,000, 9,000, 10,000, out of question. When I showed him this photo, then he said, you know, oh, thank you very much. We never knew when there was some photo. And one thing is there, which you must already be doing, one of the general's sons, he was not putting on the helmet strap and he got killed in the accident. It was after that that the rule was made that everyone will put a helmet with chin strap tight to me. And army can have the good discipline and everything. For example, I'll tell you, in time of General Karyappa, our first commander-in-chief, an officer had put his hand in his pocket and he was talking to a senior. General Karyappa saw that. So he passed the order, the pockets of all officers will be sewn. They can't put their hand in the pocket. And they dare to speak to a senior officer with their hand in the pocket. So it's like that. And that's how my journey finished. And in case of any need that you have, any guidance you have, or any help in Delhi, you are most welcome. I'll leave my address behind, and I'll be able to be of any help that I can be of. Thank you.